أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين We were discussing the topic of lawmaking at the end part of our last verse, and I told you that Surah Fatiha speaks amply on this question as well and satisfies one's conscience as to the rights of lawmaking that belong to Allah. I mentioned that the lawmaking has a direct relationship with the attribute of, that is mentioned in Surah Fatiha, Maliki Yawmiddin. It has a direct bearing with this attribute. A thing, any being which is a proprietor has also the rights to make laws. Now, when you say that, there appear to be some discrepancies in the ordinary experience, everyday experience of our life and the claim which I am making. And also, there seems to be a lacuna somewhere in the statement of Surah Fatiha, and it only seems, it doesn't exist there, but to a casual observer, there appears to be a lacuna. Whenever you think of lawmaking, the concept of sovereignty and kingdom comes to your mind. And that is described in Arabic by the word Malik and not Malik. While Surah Fatiha mentions God to be the Malik, and there are two different words. Malik means a proprietor. Maliki Yawmiddin means absolute proprietor, to whom everything ultimately belongs to the exclusion of all others. Yet the word Malik is not mentioned. In the ordinary world, in the ordinary experience of life, we observe that sometimes we are the proprietors and the lawmakers are others. They are the sovereigns. We possess a house, we possess a property, we possess any other movable or immovable assets, and the government of the country comes and makes laws and interferes with our possessions as if they belong to them. So what right do they have? And if the right really belongs to the possessor, then where is the concept of a government, the concept of a state? Because then in each case, each possessor will exercise his own personal right of making laws for himself. He can dispense of with his property as he pleases. So where is the government and taxation system and all that botheration which is bothering the present man more so than the previous man of the previous ages? Because the government has now become a developed complex system, while previously it was in the elementary stages of formation and it did not interfere with the individual life as much as we find it interfering today. Moreover, there are governments which claim the entire possession of the entire country as well, and they become absolute lawmakers as well. So, unless we first solve the enigma of these apparent contradictions, we cannot proceed in the investigation of what effect the word Malik has over the rest of the universe, and what is its relationship to lawmaking as we observe it. The important thing which is to be noted is this, that despite this apparent controversy, despite this apparent discrepancy in the world, that possession belongs to someone else and the lawmaking, the power of lawmaking belongs to someone else, in reality, the power of lawmaking belongs to the proprietor and to none other. What we observe in the world is an apparent happening. The underlying philosophy is missed. The concept of government is in fact the concept of absolute ownership and ultimate propriety. A government has absolute rights. I mean, this is the philosophy of a government. And it has the power to dispense with properties of people. So those who possess a property, as if they are possessing that property under license from the government. This is why when the new governments come into being, everybody in the country is automatically dispossessed. And the new government has the rights and laws to make as to who should possess and how he should possess a property. And everyone must have the sanction of that government. This is the underlying principle of the governments, which has developed to such complexities. In reality, the concept begins with an absolute power belonging to the government, and with the permission of that government, that power is devolved step by step to others. Now this is, although this is exactly how we find things in the world, but in reality neither the government is the proprietor nor the individual is, because according to Malik-e-Yawmiddin, the only real possessor of things, the actual proprietor, is God and none other. And this can be proved in so many ways. For instance, everything, every possession in this world is transient. Nothing belongs or can belong to anyone permanently. The governments come and go, they possess, they appropriate or misappropriate, and then they are conquered by other governments, or a revolution takes place in the country, and they are dispossessed of all they claim to possess. And they are totally forgotten and wiped out. And they also inherited their rights, either so-called lawfully or so-called unlawfully, but they inherited from others or appropriate others' rights. So it is a temporary possession in reality, for which there could be some legality or there could be no apparent legality. But if you look at it from the point of view of human beings, in reality there is no legality about it. Might is right is the only law operative in the world of human beings, because we do not possess anything by ourselves in our own right. How can the collective association, that is government, collective association of the individuals, possess those rights which are not really possessed by human beings? If we study the human progress and the concept of appropriation and property, then you will understand better what I am saying. Things which have developed to this stage are confusing now, but in reality, in the origin, nothing was possessed by anybody. Whoever captured a thing, it was the expression of his might, that gave expression in the form of property. And gradually, when that right was established through a sort of association of powerful people, and this is how the governments came into being, and this is how the property got confused with the law-making power. Law-making must belong to the possessor. The one who possesses a thing, his is the right to govern and to make laws. So because this, there is a confusion in everything in the world here, this principle cannot be clearly seen operative in the world, the principle of Malikiyat and its relationship to sovereignty. Now, having understood this fundamental, we further apply this to the human affairs once again, and we find that sovereign, by mutual agreement or by long traditions, has come to be understood a sort of partial possessor, partial proprietor, and partial lawmaker. Neither he is a complete lawmaker, nor he is a complete proprietor of things. Any government, even a communist government, cannot be considered as an absolute proprietor, because there are things belonging to individuals even in the communist system, the most advanced communist system, which we find in philosophy, which we do not find in practice. In practice, there is no such thing as absolute communism in the world today. Only the governments are traveling towards communism. In philosophy alone, you find the concept of absolute communism. And even in that philosophy, there are things which have to be possessed by individuals. It's impossible to snatch those things away from them. Although they are given to them by the state in response for certain services and as reward, or certain services rendered by that individual. But once they are given, to a limited extent, they belong to that person. So the government does not have any right to interfere in those belongings. So in fact, even a communist government is not an absolute possessor of things. As far as the lawmaking goes, again, the established practices of the world government, which we find nowadays in the world of various forms, all of them, without exception, are based on this philosophy that the government has right to interfere with individuals in lawmaking, but not absolutely. To a certain degree, they can interfere, and beyond that, they cannot. What is the law governing this division? The law governing this division is an attempt to find a happy mean between individualism and collectivism, where rights of individuals are to be guarded. There, the lawmaker has to make laws to protect those laws. Those rights. Where rights of the society, collective society, are to be guarded, then the lawmaker has to make such laws as to protect those collective rights of the society. So in fact, he is working in the capacity of a warden. The lawmaker, although he appears to be an absolute lawmaker, always works as if he is working on behalf of the people, as temporary occupier of power, to dispense justice and to be responsible for the fair play, and to equally distribute and equitably distribute rights belonging to individual and to the society. This is the fundamental underlying principle of lawmaking. So there is no absolutism found in the world of possession or in the world of lawmaking. Yet, as I have explained clearly, the right of making law belongs in reality to the one who appropriates, who is the proprietor of a thing. Otherwise, this law does not belong to others. This is why, as the prophets come, one of the major objections raised against them is this: are you going to interfere in our possessions, things which we earn, in our wealth? You are going to make laws. What right do you have? This is the first objection, or one of the most important objections. As far as the lawmaking goes, again, Surah Fatiha dispenses with these objections and lays the fundamental principle that Allah is the Malik Yawmiddin. He is the maker of things, He is the developer of things, He is the creator of the universe, He possesses complete knowledge, and He has these attributes and those attributes. But He has the most powerful attribute of all, of dispensation of things, as He pleases. And this is because He is the possessor, He is the proprietor of everything, Malik. Why is it that Malik Yawmiddin is said instead of Malik? I explained perhaps it earlier as well, that Yawmiddin is the epithet which Malik Yawmiddin as a complete expression makes the Malikiyat absolute and all comprehensive and all encompassing, because Yawmiddin means where things develop to conclusions, a time is a time where things have reached the point of conclusion and ultimate dispensation. Malik Yawmiddin means God, who is not only the possessor of things, but He is possessor from the beginning till the end, to the point where things ripen into things, where they have to be dispensed with. Now, you ordinarily in the human affairs observe the phenomena of possession, which is a sort of relayed possession throughout our history. As I have already mentioned, some people possess a thing and do not live long enough to see the conclusion of things. Other people take over and inherit their possession, and they possess the things again temporarily, and they see sometimes they eat the fruit of the previous labor. When things have ripened and come to conclusion, they dispense with those things. Yet, things which they have started, changes they have started to bring about in their possession, many a time they die before those things ripen, or they are dispossessed before those things ripen. So their malakiyat is a completely powerless malakiyat. But Allah's malakiyat has that absolute value about it. When it begins a thing, it sees it to the conclusion, and He is the proprietor of all conclusions. When things ripen, He is there. وَفَّهُ حِسَابًا, as it's mentioned in the Surah, in the Holy Quran, also refers to the same phenomena. Things begin sometimes of their own. People sometimes design things, and the dispensation does not belong to them. They propose, but things are dispensed by Allah. So this is the true Malikiyat. And the one who is the true Malik, he has to be the true sovereign. The word Malik is one letter short of the word Malik. Malik is Meem Alif Lam Kaf, and Malik is Meem Lam Kaf. And in Arabic language, this is an accepted philosophy that the words of similar nature having the same roots have greater meaning and wider meaning who possess more letters than those words which belong to the same root but possess less letters. So the word Malik in fact has that relationship at roots as well. The fundamental part of the word is Meem, Lam, Kaf, Malaka. Malaka, the one who possesses. And Malik is the one who possesses absolutely. And Malik is the one who is the sovereign, who is temporary possessor, a partial possessor of things and partial maker of law. An admixture of these partial values makes a Malik. But in case of Allah, when the word Malik applies to him, it applies in absolute terms, not in these partial terms. But when Malik is mentioned, Malik is not necessarily to be mentioned at all. Because Malik contains the word Malik as well, as I have now already explained. In light of this attribute of God, Malik Yawmiddin, we observe him to be the lawmaker. And in this regard, I was explaining the operation of lawmaking of God in various spheres of Alameen. And I narrowed my field of observation and study to the Alam of life and then subdivided it into various sections of life. And we started with the discussion on vegetative kingdom, and then we shifted to animal kingdom, and then to human kingdom. And we partially discussed it in the previous sermon, thus. Now I want to elaborate a little further on these three kingdoms of life, the vegetative kingdom, the animal kingdom, and the human kingdom. In the vegetative kingdom, we observe one differentiating feature with the animal kingdom, which is, as I mentioned earlier too, animal kingdom cannot, vegetative kingdom cannot reach out for things. Things have to be brought to it. The animal kingdom can reach out for things. So, the lawmaker has to make laws keeping this in view. Animal kingdom is the kingdom of gatherers, and the vegetative kingdom is the kingdom of life to which things must reach of themselves. Otherwise, the vegetative kingdom cannot survive. So if you observe the laws of nature in respect of their application to these various kingdoms, you will be absolutely surprised as how beautifully they are made and how extensively they are made in such detail as not to leave any minor or the minutest requirement of any kingdom anywhere in their respective fields. For instance, the vegetative kingdom requires constant supply of food from all directions to them, and the dispensation of their waste products, and the approach of energy to that kingdom, I mean the parts or the members of that kingdom, in a manner as it does not destroy them. It is rightly measured for their survival and for their progress. And all this should be done so perfectly in such complete balance as to raise them from lower order to higher order, and from higher order to still a higher order, until a new kingdom should evolve from the vegetative kingdom, that is the kingdom of the animals, where they have power of locomotion. They can reach out for things. Then new laws have to be made for that kingdom, appropriate laws applicable to that kingdom. So we observe, as I mentioned briefly in the last verse, that vegetative kingdom is governed by perfect laws. The fall of sun's energy, the supply of water, the distribution of necessary ingredients for life, and their circulation, and their constant replenishment, and not vegetative kingdom cannot reach out for things. Things have to be brought to it. The animal kingdom, weather, changes in weather, and the balance between days and nights, and the rotation of earth, all these factors play very important roles in the sustenance of vegetative kingdom. Their reproduction system, how they are to be, the reproduction system is to be maintained with or without animal kingdom. They are two different things. So we observe in the vegetative kingdom laws operative to such minute details that prior to the creation of animal kingdom, their reproductive system, their reproductive phenomena is not dependent upon animal kingdom at all, in whatever nature. There is no relationship. As the animals come into being, then we see evolution of such plants as require for their propagation and for their reproduction the help of animal kingdom, and there is mutual relationship developing from then on. So if you observe in detail the laws of nature operative in the vegetative kingdom as well as in the animal kingdom and their mutual relationship and interplay, then you realize what Malik-e Yawmiddin means and what Rububiyat means and what Rahmaniyat means and what Rahimiyat means. And when they come all into play together, what a beautiful creation we begin to observe. And that creation is in constant progress. The vegetative kingdom gives way to the animal kingdom or evolves into animal kingdom, and the animal kingdom evolves into human kingdom. What is the difference between human kingdom and the animal kingdom? Of so many differences, I'll point out one important difference, that the animal kingdom is the kingdom of gatherers, not of cultivators. وَمَا مِنْ دَابَّةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا عَلَى اللَّهِ رِزْقُهَا means, and this particularly applies to the animal kingdom as apart from human beings. Also they are broadly spoken as dabba, but this verse in particular speaks of some helpless creatures who cannot create their food. So Allah has seen to it that their food is not only supplied to them, it is created as well. In the nature we observe that the animals cannot create their own food. In whatever capacity you look at them, they cannot create their own food. Yet food is created for them. And that is helped by both vegetable kingdom and the animal kingdom itself. Most of the responsibility of food for the animal kingdom lies on the shoulders of the vegetative kingdom. And this provides the fundamental base for life. But as you progress further and enter the animal kingdom, you'll observe that Allah has made such laws as the rejected food of one animal becomes the food of another animal. So although the animals cannot make their own food, they make automatically and provide automatically food for other animals. This is why they say one man's food is another man's poison. The excretions of human beings, for instance, or any other animal, provide food for many other types of life, which are entirely dependent on those rejected excretions. Your urine, your perspiration, stools, everything is a food. For you it's a poison. If you retain urine for a while, then you suffer from hyperuremia. Urea is accumulated to the effect of its being toxic to the body. But this urea is a food for some bacteria which break it up. And the released energy is their source of life. Similarly, everything which you reject and everything which other animals reject, they provide a source of energy and food for others. This law is so quietly operating that you do not observe, as if it does not exist. But quietly and smoothly it is running in such perfect order that you have to delve deep into the operation of these laws and unveil the various curtains hiding this law in operation before you really begin to understand the Rububiyat and Malikiyat in the interplay. Malik is the maker of laws. Rububiyat is not the maker of laws. Malikiyat has provided the laws of nature which perfectly fit in with the requirement of Rububiyat. And they are diffused, they are responsible for the diffusion of Rububiyat into both vegetative kingdom and animal kingdom. Yet here, as I have already described, we reach a stage where people are, or the life is still gathering things, collecting things. But in the animal kingdom, and as we enter the animal kingdom, we observe a new phenomena developing. Man is the possessor of a quality of producing things intentionally, consciously, not for others, but for himself. And a very strange phenomena it is to observe, and so different from the previous observation on life. Previously, animals created, did not create anything for themselves. They went for things which were created already. And willy-nilly they produce things for others. Here, in the animal kingdom, man produces for himself. And in that process, what is the waste which he does not want to produce for others is automatically used by others. But he goes for the production for himself. The previous phase is called that of adaptation. All the life prior to man is adopting itself. But man begins to adopt nature to himself. This is the fundamental change which has occurred and which will now govern all the progress of humanity. A new law has come into operation. And this is the new law which is created by Allah, and which is also dispensed with by Allah in such detail as is boggling to one's mind. As I have explained, man is given the option and power to create things for himself. Now, what is creation in respect to man? That is changing the nature consciously to suit himself. The laws of nature are already there, which would provide him this interference in nature. He is not the maker of laws at all. Yet, he is the utilizer of laws. And he does it consciously towards a certain end. So, he begins to change his environment instead of changing himself to the environment as was the rule in the animal kingdom. In the animal kingdom, every species of life used to change itself or adapt itself to the environment. If it did not, then it would be wiped out. There are changes in weather and climates. And these animals have to shift according to the changing in weathers. to observe, and so different from the previous observation on life,
will be destroyed.
And they go in search of food according to the changes in weather. As the food goes on shifting its venues, the animal also goes on shifting, changing the food chains. But in human beings, as I have said, a new law has come into being. Man begins to change the nature. And when you begin to change the nature, then the rights of possession come into play. A new kingdom has been created. Previously, the animal kingdom did not have to vie or, we did not have to be governed with laws which will distribute their possessions. Violation of which laws should be considered crime. For instance, Allah has not created certain areas and regions and made certain animals possessor by right of those regions. They are gatherers. Allah is producing things for them. They vie with each other for first possessions of those things which have already been created. They consume them and forget about the place. They shift from one place to another as they need. But they are not the possessor of things because they do not have to do anything with changes required for the sustenance of themselves. This is the fundamental change which has to be born and on which I am laying so much stress, because unless you understand this phenomena very clearly, you will not begin to understand the new phase of life, that is the phase of human beings, and how new laws are required. Property is something which is only temporarily seen in animal kingdom and casually seen in animal kingdom. A nest is made by an animal and it is abandoned after some time. A place is occupied by certain species of animals and it is abandoned by them casually, because there are other laws which are not in their power which govern these things. But except for a very minute and a small role in the changing of the universe consciously, they do not change things consciously. Things are changed automatically by their presence. If the grazing animals are present somewhere, the vegetation would begin to disappear. If the animals which prey on the grazing animals are present, then the population of the grazing animals would begin to diminish and ultimately wiped out if the balance is in the favor of the preying animals. So things begin to change apparently by the influence of animals, but not consciously, not for a purpose. They live an automatic life, and in that process things begin to change. But in the animal kingdom, things are changed because they are producer of things. They employ labor on certain things, and that labor is converted into food for them. That labor is converted into food for them in a manner as animal kingdom is completely incapable of doing. For instance, you will not observe an animal sowing the seeds and tending those crops for a certain time until that crop has ripened and the food is provided and ultimately again possessed by that animal. No such phenomena is observed. So when you produce your own food, you create in your own food, participate in this phenomena, then the concept of possession completely changes. Then there have to be fights, rivalries. Begin to understand the new phase of life, that is the phase of human beings. No periods. You must have free play to develop those things. And when you develop certain things, by employing your labor upon those things, then automatically you feel the right of possession. So these nations which have developed these countries into highly advanced countries, they have put in a lot of labor of thousands of years. They possess the right of owning this country, the owning the lands and all the properties within, and to dispossess others or to guard against others coming and misappropriating these things. Similarly, these possessions are created in individual lives, or in fact the collection of individual possessions grows into states. But anyway, whichever way you look at it, new phenomena has appeared which was unknown in the animal kingdom. For this phenomena, there also has to be law making. Otherwise, there will be anarchy and confusion. To whom does the right belong of law making here? Present, then the population of the grazing animals would begin to diminish and ultimately wiped out if the balance is instead of things that is God. Surah Fatiha tells us that the right to govern and the right to make rules and the right to implement those rules belong to Allah and to none other. For so many reasons, man is incapable of truly making his own laws. In detail, perhaps he can, but in principle, in fundamentals, he cannot make his own laws. He is incapable of doing it. So all the fundamental laws regarding all activities and interests of human nature have to be created and made by Allah and Him alone. This can be further understood when we apply this principle in various fields of human interest. And now I am going to narrow this to the field of economy, because this is one of the most important questions agitating the minds of the modern human being. What sort of economy should be devised for human beings? What sort of rules should govern such economy, any economy? And when you enter the modern division of human beings into two groups, this is in fact the bone of contention. The type of laws and rules which must govern an economy. This is the major bone of contention which has divided the world into two warring camps, the leftists and the rightists. And both are vying with each other for the ultimate power so that the other system is wiped out and their own system survives. And this rivalry is causing so many fears and trepidations in the minds of human beings. And they are not certain of their future as to what may come. The fundamental rights here belong to Allah. This is the claim of Surah Fatiha. And this claim is totally denied by both the communists and the capitalists. The same question, the same simple elementary question, which was raised against the prophets, that how can you interfere with our properties, with our possessions? Is reality is not in words, is raised not in words, but in reality, in practice. And when you speak to the communist world as to the rights of Allah to govern laws of economy and the laws of distribution of wealth, they would say, what Allah? What right has he got? We are human beings, we are possessor of things, we own states, we own property. In detail, perhaps he can. But in principle, in fundamentals, he cannot make his own laws to our affairs. When you speak to the capitalists of the requirement of taking their guideline and light from Allah, who is to whom, as we believe, belongs the right of lawmaking, they say, what are law? We are happy with our lawmaking. We know what is good for us and what is bad for us. We are adults. We have reached maturity. So you are talking of the old days, perhaps, of the old man when he was not yet fully developed. Now the man, the modern man, has such wide and such complete knowledge of things. He has come of his age. So why to bring Allah into things? He has no right. And they think that this is an objection which has come their way, division of human beings into two groups. This is in fact the bone of contention. The type of laws and rules which must govern an economy. This is the major bone of contention which has divided the world into two warring camps, the leftist and the rightist. And both are vying with each other for the ultimate power so that the other system is wiped out and their own system survives. And this rivalry is causing so many fears and trepidations in the minds of human beings, and they are not certain of their future as to what may. You are given the rights of possession in the Garden of Eden, but every plant does not belong to you. You must eat of certain fruits and must not eat of certain other fruits. So the whole story of religion begins with these rites. This is why Shu'aib and other prophets are objected against. And the people they address, they say, what rights do you have to interfere? So the religion has a definite relationship with the world of human economy, right from the very inception of religion. This question must not be forgotten. So any separation between religion and economic system and the system of distribution of wealth is a denial of religion itself, because you cannot conceive of religion without making laws for human beings in the distribution of their wealth. And it has to be like that, because Surah Fatiha demands it. And now I will further explain how Surah Fatiha demands and to what extent Surah Fatiha demands the making of these laws by the Supreme Being who is responsible for our creation. But before proceeding further, let me again remind you that when Allah makes laws, the laws of Allah must bear the character of Allah. And the character of Allah, as described in Surah Fatiha, is of four fundamental qualities: Rububiyat, Rahmaniyat, Rahimiyat and Malikiyat-e-Yawmiddin. Rububiyat is a mixture of Rahmaniyat and Rahimiyat, of course. Yet it has come into its own as an independent quality as well, because it interplays in the with the upbringing of all created things in a manner which we know as Rububiyat. So by itself it can be treated as an independent characteristic of God, but though it is a mixture of Rahmaniyat and Rahimiyat. So these four characters of the Creator have to find their imprint on everything He makes, things or laws. So all laws of nature and all laws governing the affairs of man must bear these characters. Now, we have already spoken on one important prerequisite of lawmaking, that is complete knowledge. Knowledge is highly important for lawmaking. And if you lack knowledge, then you lack the capability of make appropriate laws. This I have already discussed last time. And we discussed the issue of requirements. When you dispense with the requirements of the people, you must know the requirements. And you must know those things which fulfill the requirements. Otherwise, you cannot make the proper law. On this I have already spoken. But it should be understood in general that knowledge has a direct relationship with the quality of law. And they are directly equated. That is to say, the greater the knowledge, the better would be the law which is made by that being which possesses certain knowledge. The less the knowledge, more mistakes would be committed in the lawmaking. So because Allah is the creator of things, according to the claim of Surah Fatiha, Rahman al-Rahim, and He has brought human beings to this level of development, He alone knows all the details of human requirements and all the things which fulfill those requirements. Apart from that, another thing is required, the knowledge of dispensation, the knowledge of natural dispensations of things. Unless you know the factors responsible for behavior, and you know the behavioral science of a species, you cannot make appropriate laws for that species. So before coming to tackle the question of economic system, we are first preparing the ground for that. Lawmaking requires all these things. And requirement of lawmaking demand that you must know the nature of things, the behavior of certain species or class of life before you begin to make laws for that species. Now this science has now developed into a highly complex science. Previously, human beings thought that they can make laws regarding crime and punishment and acts of goodness and reward because they thought they could understand human beings very well. But now, recently, the doubts have been raised by psychologists and other scientists of this field. And they begin to claim that previous laws made by human beings applying to the human social behavior have all been proved to be wrong because we have gained certain knowledge about human dispensations and human characteristics which was not possessed by earlier human beings, which throw more light on the nature of man, why he commits crimes, why he abstains from committing crimes, the motive forces, where he is responsible for certain things, where he is not responsible for certain things. Now, unless you know all these things, how can you make laws effectively governing the behavior of human beings? And how can you dispense with justice equitably without lack of knowledge, without knowledge, perfect knowledge on these things? I illustrate this by an example. Now, a man has committed a murder. The laws of the land differ in this regard. But whatever the laws of punishment be, they agree on one thing, that each murder has to be taken individually on its own merit. And one passing judgment, sweeping judgment should not be passed on each murder while the fact remains that the murder has been committed and the fact of murder remains the same anywhere in the world. A murder here and a murder in Pakistan is fundamentally the same thing. A murder by A and a murder of B, as far as the result is concerned, are the same things. So why should the punishment differ? All the human beings agree. The punishment must differ because the circumstances of murder differ. The necessities of murder differ. Some murders are committed in self-defense. A different law should be made for that. Some murders are committed by madmen who have no control over their actions. So the law of punishment should differ in that regard. Some murderers were compelled by certain circumstances, and some murderers were not compelled to that extent by those circumstances. So every murder has to be treated individually. And previously human beings thought that they know all the factors responsible for dispensation of justice because the factors they brought into computation were the factors of how much one was compelled, how much one was coaxed to do certain things, and whether somebody was attacked or not attacked. But the latest development of psychology have brought other factors into the focus. And those factors are called the social environmental factors and their relationship to the genetics, the laws of genetics. And they say that genetical laws also play a very important role. Certain people have inherited certain traits and characteristics which have gone into their genes. And they are bound to act in certain situations because they are controlled by those genes, those characters retained in those genes. And they automatically issue orders to those men in certain situations and they cannot behave otherwise. They have to obey those genetic orders and they cannot defy those orders because they are built like that. A certain medicine, a certain chemical released by pituitary glands is responsible for certain actions of human beings. The amount of that secretion is not an accidental thing. It is determined by the genetic codes which govern all these things. And each individual has different genetic code. Those genetic codes vary. As a class, they have the same genetic code. But as individuals, there are variations. So in certain cases, other glands also play a role and the collective result of which gives expression into human behavior is different from man to man. And all these things are beyond individual control. That is to say, in a given circumstances, Mr. A, as governed by his genetic orders, will behave differently from Mr. B, and Mr. B will behave differently from Mr. C, because their genetic codings are different. The situations remain the same. The oppression is the same, or the injustice committed to them is the same, but the behavior is different. So the genetic coding comes into play here. And the environment also plays an important role, and there has to be stricken a balance somewhere. So the whole concept of criminology, cause and effect, crime and punishment, is undergoing rapid changes in the modern time because the new sciences have shed light on the inadequate knowledge of previous human beings, hence the necessity of change in the law. So how can the right of lawmaking belong to such a being who is so inadequate in his knowledge that each era of human development changes the requirement of lawmaking. And so he must shift on and on from one law to another, considering himself to be making perfect laws, while each law is only a relative law and is not a perfect law. This shows the necessity of a being who has the perfect knowledge and who alone possesses the right to make laws. The same exactly applies to the economic laws and the laws governing the wealth and the distribution of property and possessions and so on and so forth. Another thing which is very important for lawmaking is the object and purpose of the creation of certain things. Unless you understand the ultimate object and purpose of a thing, you cannot make laws adequately for that thing. Human beings are a very complex being. If you do not know the purpose of creation of human beings, you cannot make laws for human beings because they may contradict the ultimate purpose of creation. They may come into conflict with the ultimate purpose of creation. And this also applies to the economic laws. This is why neither the capitalist system is capable of devising laws for, suitable laws for human beings in these fields, nor the communist system is capable of doing it, because they do not have the adequate knowledge of the purpose of creation. There are two theories. Either of the two is correct. One is automatic, spontaneous, unguided generation of life, which goes on traveling in a direction which is a blind direction. Nobody is controlling that direction. And the other theory, which is the religious theory, is this: that man and all life is created to serve a certain purpose, and that purpose is defined, and the direction of life is always in the pursuance of that objective. It's not just a blind meandering motion in any direction. It is a set motion in a certain direction. This is the theory which has been explained in the Holy Quran, where it says, and in many other places, Rabbana ma khalaqta hadha batila subhanaka faqina azab an-nar. O our Lord, you have not created us in vain. You have created us with a purpose. And what is that purpose? That purpose is worship. And that purpose is described in the Holy Quran, ma khalaqtul jinna wal insa illa liyabudun. We have not created big men and small men, but for the sole purpose of worship. So all laws governing every sphere of human beings must bear in mind this purpose. If you do not recognize this purpose, and if you do not bring into play all the requirements of this purpose, then your lawmaking would be insufficient or defective to that effect. To this conclusion, Surah Fatiha is carrying us, because after the declaration that Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Malik Yawmiddin, suddenly we are brought to the realization, Iyyaka Na'budu wa Iyyaka Nasta'in. We are going to worship thee, and thee alone are we going to worship, because this is the purpose of creation. So if this be the purpose of creation, then laws regarding any human activity must conform to this purpose, must contribute to this purpose. If they lack to recognize this purpose, they would become defective. So, when you realize this, immediately, both the big systems, capitalistic and the communist system, are dispossessed of the right to make laws for human beings. Because they do not know the purpose of the human creation. In fact, they deny the purpose of human creation. They revolt against this purpose. They say there is no worship, no being worthy of worship, no creator. So when they deny the very existence of the creator and the only being which is worthy of worship, how can they make laws which should be appropriate for human consumption or human governance while they do not confirm to the purpose of their creation? They don't agree to the purpose of that creation. So they would naturally be defective in that regard. Look at it from any angle, the right of making law would revert to Allah, who is the proprietor, who is the ruler of all things, who has the perfect knowledge of everything, and who knows the purpose of creation, and who is guiding mankind, or all life, we should say, to a certain goal for which that life is created. Another thing, as I said, mentioned earlier, was that the law making must be governed by the four basic fundamental characteristics: Rububiyat, Rahmaniyat, Rahimiyat and Malikiyat. Human beings do not possess this. And certain laws made by the human beings are in total contradiction of these fundamental characteristics of God. For instance, in this regard too, we can compare the Islamic economic system with the communist economic system. In principle, I mean, not in detail. In principle, if God is Rahman, if God is Rab, if God is Rahim and Malik Yawmuddin, He must devise a system for human beings which confirms to these four characteristics, which does not violate these fundamental principles. But the communist system violates these principles in detail as well. For instance, it revolts against the concept of Rahmaniyat. Rahmaniyat means, among other things, a dealing of things with overwhelming compassion and mercy and forbearance. Everything you deal with must not have a quality of revolt and revenge and cruelty about it. As you go about things, your manner of approaching things must be guided and controlled by beneficence of Allah, by magnificence as well, and by kindness and all that is soft about it. Human nature is made like this, and it reacts to the best in the best manner if this soft approach is made in governing human affairs. But the communist system is based on hatred, on revenge. While the religious system, whether it applies to economy or other things, always is based on Rahmaniyat. This is the fundamental difference between the approach of Adam and Satan, which has been mentioned in that fable which is so well known and which I have repeatedly referred to. Satan is made of fire and Adam is made of wet clay. Water and made of mud or wet clay or things. Now the basic fundamental difference in the characteristics of fire and wet clay is this, that fire destroys and the progress and productivity. And the fire is the symbol of hatred and revenge. While wetness and the softness of the clay, which can be molded in various fashions, is the representative symbol of all that is kind and all that can give way to productivity. Cohesion. Water is a symbol of cohesion, and the fire is a symbol of separation of things, disintegration of things. So the communist philosophy is based on fire power, on hatred and revenge. This is why all the motive force they derive from hatred. No communist revolution can take place anywhere in the world unless they employ hatred as their fundamental energy or motive force. While Islam dispenses away with hatred before claiming to create a new world. So the very concept of how new world order is to be created is so fundamentally different. The one concept is governed by Rahmaniyat, and the other concept is governed by the rebellions against Rahmaniyat. In communist philosophy, there is no concept of Rahmaniyat whatsoever. It has to be revenge and forceful appropriation and breaking of world order and burning of things and destroying of the order and so on and so forth. Everything which is violent is observed in communist system of the new world order. Everything which is soft and forgiving and sacrificing is witnessed in the religious revolutions. There is no vengeance. There is overwhelming forgiveness. There is persuasion. There is a gradual change which is brought about in the nature of things, in the attitudes of men. And the sacrifice is not forced upon others. In fact, sacrifice is offered by those who want to bring about the great change. Strict laws are to be observed in dispensation of justice. No innocent blood is to be shed in the process of this great achievement of a new revolution. But in communist system, all these governing or limiting factors are totally lacking, because they base their concept of revolution on the rebellion of Rahmaniyat. Rahmaniyat is an obsolete value as far as the communist system goes. Similarly, in the capitalist system, there is no concept of Rahmaniyat. There is total disregard for the oppressed. If you have power, you can continue to oppress others and keep your oppression as long as you may please, because you have power. And there is no concept of Rahmaniyat in the capitalist system either. But in according to Surah Fatiha, all human relationship should be governed by Rahmaniyat and Rahimiyat too. And when you come to the Rahimiyat, then also there is a denial of Rahimiyat in communist system as well as in the capitalist system. To some degree in the capitalist system, to a greater degree in the communist system. Rahimiyat requires that such laws should govern the human affairs where whatever you contribute to the society, you should be well rewarded. This is the fundamental principle of Rahimiyat. Whether you leave that thing or not, this question comes later. When you earn a thing, you must possess that thing. It must belong to you because you have earned it. Otherwise, the incentive will be lacking for the future progress. This principle has played a very important role in upbringing of life to the stage of humanity and also shaping the human life. and guaranteeing the unlimited progress of to some extent. Rahimiyat means if you put in your labor in bringing about the change of some sort, your labor must be rewarded, not only to the extent that you have put in labor, but even more than you have put in should can be given to you as reward by way of incentive. This is Rahimiyat. As I explained, it is because of Rahimiyat that we are surviving. You put in labor of sowing a seed. That seed is just one seed. It grows into so many that your own seed that you sowed is returned to you plus a few hundred other seeds which came along with it. This conversion of labor into multiplication of your efforts, this is called Rahimiyat. And this is a constant process which is observed in every human field. So, this should apply to the other human affairs as well. In governing our economic systems, our systems of property, our system of distribution of wealth, and our system of individual labor and its employment and its reward. All these things should be governed by Rahimiyat. Otherwise, they would be defective according to the claim of Surah Fatiha. The communist system claims to each one according to his needs. That is to say, how much labor he has put in has become irrelevant. Need is the important factor. On this I have already spoken that need cannot be defined correctly by human beings because of lack of knowledge. And lack of good disposition towards certain individuals or people. When you are holding the absolute power in a state, sometimes you do not understand the needs of certain individuals or classes, and sometimes you are not well disposed towards those people. And you say this is your need, and do away with them, with their requirements, by giving them much less than they require. So, this cannot be adequately handled on this principle. But this is not which I am now repeating. What I am pointing out is this, that according to Rahimiyat, if you put in your labor, you must possess the reward. And you should not be deprived of the fruit of your labor on the excuse that you do not need that much. Just by declaring this. If you are dispensed with the fruit of your labor on the excuse that you do not require this much, and it is we who are going to decide how much you require, then the Rahimiyat goes overboard and there is no concept of Rahimiyat left in this relationship. Islam bases all its laws on Rahimiyat as well. So Islam does not agree with this principle. Islam has a different principle guided under Rahimiyat. And it says that each one must get what he earns. Everybody should be given what he has rightfully earned. The word rightful will be defined later on. But let's now come to the point of earning. Whatever one earns rightfully must belong to him. Laha ma kasabat is the principle. Not for him what he needs, but for him what he earns. Although there are laws governing how things should be earned, that is a different question. But under the given laws, when you really earn something, that must belong to you. This is Rahimiyat. Who is to decide whether you have more than your need or less than your need? In the first place, you as individual are to decide this. يَسَلُونَكَ مَاذَا يُنْفِقُونَ قُلِ الْعَفْوَ. They ask you what you should spend in the way of Allah or for the society. قُلِ الْعَفْوَ. Say whatever is left over from your need. And that is to be decided by the individual in most cases who has earned. That is one way of dispensation of wealth in the society, where each one earns what possesses what he earns, and himself decides what is over and above his needs. This is the system of Rahimiyat. But the system of Rububiyat also comes into play. And the system of Rububiyat requires that no individual in any society should be left without such needs as are fundamental or necessary for its development. Every individual must be given those minimum basic needs of life which are required for its survival. That is the law of Rububiyat, that also comes into play. And there is also the law of Rahmaniyat, that everybody should be provided with the initial capital to do things, the basic requirements where he should, with the help of which he should put his labor into practice. This is also a requirement of Rahmaniyat. So when you conceive of an Islamic economic system, you conceive the Islamic economic system within the four walls of these characteristics of God, and they give shape and modification. Characteristics of God. So we are gradually we'll develop it, and we'll see how these characteristics come into play. Number one, according to Islamic system, each one must be declared rightful possessor of that which he earns. And no third party is given the right to declare that he has earned more than he needs, his needs, so that much should be taken away from him. Number two, he must also see to the fact that he should contribute to the society and become Rahim and Rahman and Rab to others, because he also has the characteristics of God. So he should decide how much he can spare of volition or of his free will for the other people, other human beings, and how much he should contribute to the welfare of the society. And there the governing principle is that of afu. Third, there must not be in a society a person who is described as needy in the sense that he is deprived of the barest minimum, and mahroom in the sense that he does not possess the initial requirements which, if employed, would earn him a better living or would provide him with means to progress. So for that Allah has made a guiding principle, which is وَفِي أَمْوَالِهِمْ حَقٌّ مَعْلُومٌ لِلسَّائِلِ وَالْمَحْرُومِ. In the possessions of every human being, there may be rights of others intermingled. And who are others? Who are either mahroom or sail? Either they are deprived of the basic necessities of life, which were important for their survival or their useful participation in economic system, or they are deprived of their needs to certain such an extent that they have to beg for their survival. Mahroom also has other meanings, but now I am going to explain certain meaning of mahroom, which may be new to you. Acha, bas. Mahroom here, I am describing the meaning of mahroom in a completely new light. Here, mahroom would mean somebody who is deprived of means, which if he had in his possession, he could employ his labor to those means and become a useful member of the earning society. He could participate in the wheel of economy, in the motion of the wheel of economy. That is a mahroom. He wants to do something. He has got his own power, his own labor to employ, but nothing to employ it with, nothing to employ upon anything. Such a person would be called a mahroom. He has intentions, good intentions all the time, to participate, to become a healthy member of the earning society, but can't do it. And sahil would be a person of his needs to an extent. Otherwise, he'll be wiped out. So, as long as these two things, as these two persons, types of persons are existent in the society, it is not for you to decide whether you have some extra wealth in your possession. Does not matter to you. Allah has already declared. As long as society has mahroomin and sailin, the deprived people and the beggars, there are definitely certain people in the society who possess. And here the state is to decide, not they themselves individually. This is how Rububiyat and Rahimiyat and Rahmaniyat come into joint play and evolve these economic laws. And these laws are non-existent, both in the economic system of capitalism and the economic system of communism, because they are not governed by Rububiyat, Rahmaniyat and Rahimiyat and Malik-e-Yawmiddin, Malikiyat as well, but of that later, inshallah. Today's sermon was rather difficult for laymen to understand. So I observed people dozing off much more today than previously. But this was a difficult train we had to cover, because I am going to carry you along